See, the hall is really empty. We are all tired after the 3-day conference, so I understand the students whom Amit is searching, they are...
The trouble is we gave them assignments.
Okay, maybe they are...
We made them work, so...
Okay, so anyway... As Vasu said, we are facing the embarrassment of talking in the conference which we are organizing. But anyway, the conference is mainly for exchange of ideas. So we decided we will also present what we have been doing, although since it falls in the same data assimilation area. So we would like to have your comments, suggestions and ideas on this. So the title should have been really 4D var for Berger's equation, but I did call it optimal control because that is where I started from originally. And my co-workers are Amit Apte and Sumant Bharadwaj, who did all the numerical simulations for us and successfully gave us the good interpretations, and also DVA Oru, who was here last week and beginning of this conference from University of Toulouse. So how it came about is when Amit came, he started talking about data assimilation, and that was the same time I started this Indo-French project with Toulouse, and Didier Oro was in that time in Toulouse, and he came and talked about various methods for data assimilation. And my background being optimal control and things like variational problems. So that was very appealing to me, so we wanted to try it out. And we realized that 4D var is not being used in many of the operational centers. So after that we decided, let us try to understand what is 4D var. But we have to do it in a very simple model, not the original atmospheric or oceanic models, which are too complicated. So we started with this 1D model of Berger's equation, and we tried to do what assimilation we could be doing in this. So that is how this all started about. So our idea was to try out various data assimilation problems and compare, and then so that we have a recipe for putting in the realistic models later on. So that was the starting point. So I'll talk about, of course we all know by now what is data assimilation, so let us not spend too much time on that. Then I'll introduce the Viskas-Berger's equation. We picked this model because it has the quadratic nonlinearity as the Navier-Stokes equation, and it enjoys this property that we can find exact solutions. There are exact solutions with which we can check our computed, numerically simulated solutions. And so that is why this model was picked. And then I do a little bit about necessary conditions for optimality, how we computed the adjoint. So when we started this 4D work, computation of adjoint was really a daunting problem. So we wanted to see whether we can do it for this Berger's equation completely. Then I present some of the numerical results and discussions. Okay, so the data assimilation, it's a method, as we know by now, it's a method for combining the observations with the results of previous numerical simulations and to produce the best estimate possible for the system. So we have seen many methods now. Some of the methods that I have listed, because these are the ones we were thinking of, 4D var. And then our aim was to do Bayesian and probably Ensemble-Kalman filter and back and forth nudging, but we have not gone that far. So let me start with the model. So the mathematical model for UXT, so the domain is now x is varying in 0, 1 and t is varying for some time 0 to capital T. So this is the equation, this is d by dx of u square. So this nonlinearity is the interesting feature in this Berger's equation. So we took a very simple boundary condition, and if you give the initial condition as little u of x, And we wanted to see whether whether we can pose, we can do a data assimilation problem for this using certain observations. Okay. So we let, the problem is well posed. I wanted to talk about a little the observation operator. So this space, solution space will be H1 0 of 0 1. And the capital U of xt, the capital U of xt lives in this W0t, which I have written. This depends for each t, it will be in V. And the control of this U, which is the initial condition, is the control. And our aim is to use the rough estimate of the initial condition and do a data assimilation and get the correct initial condition. So that was the problem. So observation of the state is given by some z that may be in another Hilbert space, capital Z, because typically the observations may not be in the same space where your solution lives. So we assumed C is a continuous linear map, and so this is going to be our cost functional. This is the mismatch between the solution and the observations, and you have a regularizing term. This UB is going to be a background term or a rough estimate for your initial condition, which we assume is already known. And alpha is going to be some parameter which we will see how best we can work with.
Can you just remind me where the little U comes in the equation? If you go back,
this is the little u. The little u, initial condition. The little u is the initial condition which we are trying to estimate, get a better. Okay, so then we were looking for some theoretical results. Is there a, when is the unique minimum and can we estimate for which time? And so it was one paper of Andrew White at the end I will give you. So there exists a T naught depending on mu and the bound on the initial conditions and coefficients. There exists a unique minimum for J, and hence numerically we should be able to get the unique minimum. So this is what we wanted to do. So we can put it as the control formulation. So we have the mathematical model for U, which is given by the Burgers, and I repeat the data Z and the approximate initial condition. So we are trying to find the optimal initial condition which minimizes the mismatch or the distance between the state. This is the projection to the observation space. This is the set of observations, and this, the background term is UB. So find the U that minimizes J. So this is the problem, which is the 4D var actually by now. So let me go to the next one. Yeah. So if you go to the optimal control theory, that tells you what are the optimality conditions. So let us first write down the optimality conditions. So this, you can imagine, this is the set of necessary conditions to be satisfied by the minimizer. So that involves the PXT, which is the adjoint state, or you can imagine this is a kind of a Lagrange multiplier in this problem, because we are going to use the PDE as the constraint, and that throws up this P, and the P will satisfy the adjoint equation. I have written down for the simple case when alpha is 0, otherwise there will be one more term on the right hand side. So this adjoint equation satisfies the same boundary condition, but with the terminal condition we take it to be 0. Differentiating J, we will have to, this is the derivative which we want to find out. And if you calculate this by using the equation for capital U, that gives you the famous relation for the adjoint. That is, the DJU is precisely given by P0, where P is the adjoint solution. So our aim is to calculate the derivative by running this equation backward to find out P0. This is what we also saw in Varahan's lectures for the finite dimensional system in the last week. So let me go to the next one. So our first task was to solve the Burgers equation and find a scheme which will be good as for the forward as well as for the backward. So initially we tried various things and we finally settled for implicit centered and lax Friedrichs. The upwind scheme is the natural one, but it didn't work very well for the back, for the backward problem. Because you remember the backward problem that I go back, that is the adjoint of the linearized problem. So I have to linearize the scheme. So the scheme better be differentiable. So if I have a modulus x of term that is going to pose some problems, of course it can be done, but that is another story. So we stuck to these two schemes, the lax Friedrichs and implicit centered. So I'll tell you the comparison. The comparison is, first we had to check the error, relative errors. So the maximum error in this case, you see, I have plotted delta t by delta x. And what happens is the truncation error is growing as the ratio. If I fix the delta x, then the minimum is only for very small delta t. So that means we cannot take a large step size. Interestingly, if I go to the next scheme, there was a possibility of choosing a larger delta t, because this is for various delta x, unfortunately it's in superimposed. So let us take one typical curve. So what it shows is, it's because of this delta x square by delta t term, what happens is, I have a small window where I can choose my delta t, but still have a small error. So we decided to go for Lax-Friedrich scheme, for which we were able to take larger step size and go ahead. So then let me come to the problem, what discrete time observation problem. So if you assume the earlier continuous problem, we assumed that the projection was the C, but in practice we are not given observations for all time and at all points. So we'll assume that the observations are given at a finite number m of points in space and also finitely many times. Another problem is, this may not be given at the grid points but at some other points. Then we used interpolation to get it in the grid points and then compare these values. This is, recall this capital U is the solution coming out of the model problem, the Burgers equation, and UB is the background term. Okay, so this is the discrete version of the fast function. Then I the one of the discretization, if you do for the Burgers equation, we end up with the matrix equation I minus A, the UM, which is a vector. M is the time step. So the time step M, we have this vector UM is given by the previous solution UN minus 1, the solution at the time M minus 1. So the adjoint of the discretized problem came out to be like this, and this was the derivative that we were trying to calculate. So once I know the derivative, we can do any of the conjugate gradient methods, steepest descent method, and then we can do the iteration by choosing the step size. So I just described briefly the algorithm. So we started with the initial guess U0. The initial guess is going to be the guess for your initial condition which we are trying to find out. Okay. So the iterative algorithm goes like this. You have to add rho n times dn, and what is dn? That is the gradient descent direction. And in each iteration, what does it involve? We first solve the forward problem using one of the discretizations. And then we have to use the corresponding conjugate, corresponding adjoint problem for the backward one to calculate P. That will give me P at 0, and then I have the gradient. Once I know the gradient, we put it in, we have the next iterate. So this is how the algorithm goes. Now let me briefly describe the results. So the initial condition, so the true solution, we wanted to recover the, remember the true U0, that is the initial condition, that is what we are trying to do. So let me, the blue line is the true solution which we are trying to recover. Okay, what is the green one? That is my initial iterate, U0, okay, from where we started. So that is the initial guess. And from there, after the iteration, we did converge, although alpha. So what do I mean by il post? The alpha is zero. When alpha is zero, it is not really, it's the case where you can have multiple minima. So it is not necessarily that you will converge to this correct solution. But here it did happen because the initial guess and the true solutions were somewhat similar. In particular, they had only one hump. If I give a more oscillatory one, then it is, doesn't happen. I hope you can see. The true solution is the blue one. And the final solution is not that close because the background solution is forcing it to go away from the true solution. Because the problem, as I said, alpha is zero. So the background solution is the one, the term is not there. And because of this, multiple minimas are appearing. And one of the minima is this, what we are finding as the final solution. This is one of the local minimas. Although the true solution is the one of the minimas, but we are not able to capture correctly with that. So let me go to the case where alpha is positive. So what is the alpha? Alpha was multiplying the u minus ub, the background term. Okay. So if you compare here, what is happening? This was the background term. So you see this is far away from the true solution. In particular, it has several oscillatory things, whereas the true solution did not have any oscillation, but still the solution, final solution after iterations did converge to the true solution. But that also depended on the alpha. Here I have put the alpha, I think is 0.05. If alpha is more, we are converging better towards the true solution. And if alpha is less, it's going to be a combination of background plus the true solution. Okay, so yeah, let me summarize now. So what is the work on? We set up an optimal control formulation of the data assimilation problem, which is the 4D work problem for the Berger's equation model. And we numerically computed the solution when the data is given at discrete times at grid points or outside the grid points. And what is our future we want to do? We want to extend the computations for other cases and also use the sequential methods, in particular ensemble Kalman filter and back and forth nudging. And the main thing is use realistic ocean models with real data. So the ultimate goal is probably now that we have the steps ready and computing the adjoint is not all that difficult as we feared initially. So we think we should be able to take on the real atmospheric model or oceanic model. And I heard from one of the participants that they are planning to do on an experimental basis the 4D war with the UK Met Department, and hopefully we will have some interaction in setting up this. So that with that I end my talk. If you have any questions, comments or suggestions, I'm happy to take it. Thank you.
Is there I kind of missed this, but is there a relationship between the numerical grid and the times at which you observe? I mean, do you adjust the numerical grid to fit
yes.
the times that you observe?
The observation need not be on the numerical grids. So in that case, we use the interpolation to arrive at the...
Oh, in time as well as space.
Ah, okay.
Space I'm used
to,
but yeah, but the numerical, yeah, I see the numerical.
Ensemble Kalman filter.
Yes.
I would strongly urge that it not be a bad idea to check whether the EKF would be suffice or not, because there is one paper in the Journal of Meteorology wherein they have used ensemble column filter together with the EKF and compared the performance and showed that in many cases EKF is good enough and you need not have to go for a very sophisticated time consuming ensemble column filter with so many members that it runs. So it may be a good idea to look into that.
Yes.
And further, I also suggest the tuning is something, you know, if somebody says EKF is performing as well as ensemble, I personally would like to know, is it the modeling deficiency or is it the tuning deficiency which is speaking in terms of the, each one of them? One is very, very careful. I would like to suggest. I can give the reference for the that paper, the general reader, the EKF and ensemble. You can just have a look at it.
Yeah. That will be very useful because I agree, EKF is less computationally intensive.
Yes, yes.
So they should probably try first with EKF and then with ensemble. What do you
and think? They also measured cost function to assess the performance EKF and ENKF. A very nice paper.
I see.
Yes.
We would like to have it.
Yes.
Thank you.
So you mentioned here that you are up to get a local optimum.
Any other questions?
And add a control term. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. So I guess let's thank Maithili again. And